This is my Bible. It is the living word of God. My mind is renewed. My spirit is prepared to receive the word which produces faith. And faith pleases God. I'm not just a hearer. I'm a doer. This word has given me life, and life more abundantly. Hallelujah. Please stay standing. Go to Mark chapter 4, please. Mark chapter number 4. I want you to go to verse number 3 tonight. Again, good to see everybody. We welcome everybody watching live on our internet campus tonight. God bless you. We love you tonight. And hope that you're going to be blessed tonight. Mark chapter 4, verse number 3. Listen, behold, the sower went out to sow. And it happened as he sowed that some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds of the air came and devoured. Some fell on stony ground where it did not have much earth. So it did have no depth. And immediately it sprang up because it had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, it was scorched. And because it had no root, it withered away. Look at somebody and say, you need to be rooted or you're going to wither. And some seed fell among thorns, and thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no crop. But other seed fell on good ground and yielded a crop that sprang up, increased, and produced some 30, some 60, and some 100-fold. Go to verse number 15. And these are the ones by the wayside where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan comes immediately and takes away the word that was sown in their heart. These likewise are the ones sown on stony ground, who when they hear the word, immediately they receive it with gladness. But watch this, because they have no root in themselves, and so endure only for a time. What happens for most folk in the body of Christ is they never root themselves to anything. And when you will not stand for anything, you will fall for everything. But watch this, verse number 17, and they have no root in themselves. Watch this. And so it endures only for a time. Lord, I've been trusting you. It's been 2 weeks. Yeah. Afterward, when tribulation or persecution arises for the word's sake, immediately they stumble. Well, watch this. Let me help your neighbor. Your neighbor, God has made incredible promises to them. But the problem is when the trouble that goes along with that promise starts coming, they get scared. You miss what I just said. Please understand, the Lord says, I'll bless you, but I'll bless you, and there's going to be persecution attached to it. Because I'm not going to give my best to seeing our saints. You didn't hear what I just said. God says, I need to make sure you qualify for this. And that's the problem with some folk, is that they give all of their best stuff to people that don't deserve it. They keep casting pearls before swine, and they wonder why they keep getting disappointed. Y'all ain't going to say nothing. Look at it. Look, verse 18. Now these are the ones sown among the thorns. They hear the word, and the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the desire for other things entering in choke the word. They got a promise, but because it took too long, they don't want to do that no more. So it chokes the word, and it becomes what? Unfruitful. But these are the ones sown on good ground. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm sowing in good ground. The ones who hear the word, accept it or receive it, and they bear fruit. Look at it. Some 30-fold, some 60-fold. What does it say? Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, in 09, stop waiting on God and start commanding your harvest. Father, I decrease that you might increase. Speak through me now, Father. Taylor, make this word for us, your people, tonight, that we might move in those things that you've ordained. In Jesus' name, somebody shout amen. Before you take your seat, just slap two people a high five and say, command your harvest. Command your harvest. Be seated in the presence of the Lord tonight. But please understand this. I said this already. How you exit a thing is how you enter a thing. Please understand, Christians are very good at starting things, but what we got to work on is our ability to finish things. A lot of people are able to do what it takes to make a baby, but they're not able to father that child throughout. Y'all ain't going to talk to me tonight. And so what happens is a lot of people know how to stand at the altar and say a bunch of stuff and sing Kirk Franklin's song about love, a word that comes and goes and all that. But when the marriage get a little rough, all of a sudden now, that word that they got, well, what happened to it? I thought you said for good or for worse, for better, for I thought you made an agreement. Doesn't matter. Say, I thought we had an agreement. Please understand this. So I'm not here to beat us up tonight. I'm here to get us in divine position. Say position. Because please understand, the Bible says that we have been redeemed of the Lord. That, but please understand, God says, what I have done for you is I imputed my righteousness for you. So often in the body of Christ, we talk about seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and all these things. And people quote that to sound spiritual, and they have no clue what it means. To seek the kingdom. The kingdom is what? Heaven's attributes on earth. It is what? God's M.O. It's how he does things. And so if I'm going to seek kingdom, I got to seek the way God does stuff. See, the world says get all you can and can all you get. But that ain't what the word teaches. The word teaches that if I sow, I can expect a harvest. So y'all ain't going to say nothing to me tonight. And so what's important is, please understand, seek ye first what? Kingdom of God and his what? Righteousness. Now, please understand, a lot of people take that, you know, and we got this whole thing where, you know, if you sin twice, you're disqualified. You know, and you, holiness. Holiness is right. And holiness is right. But since you couldn't get it right, he was holy for you in your place, and he imputed righteousness for you. Y'all ain't said nothing, because you look real spiritual tonight, but if we played the TV on what happened in your life in 08, there'd be some stuff you'd start tipping out about because you wouldn't want nobody to know that was you. Y'all ain't going to be real with me tonight. You're holy not because of anything you do outside of confessing Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and making a decision to repent. The Hebrew word means to literally turn from. That's what makes you holy. God ain't asking you to be perfect. He's asking you to be consistent. Bishop, doesn't the Bible say be perfect for as your Father in heaven is perfect? Read the whole thing in context, Junior. You read it in context, you'll understand. He says you're perfected by love. See, if you love your wife, you won't cheat on your wife. And I ain't here to judge you tonight, but please understand, if you love your neighbor, you're not going to do anything to intentionally harm them. Look at somebody and say, love. So now watch this. Say, the way I end a thing is how I enter a thing. Please understand, 2009, and I've been saying it for weeks, is the year of the harvest. Watch this. God has already set you up for harvest. Now I said, Bishop, what are you talking about? I ministered, you need to get this tape tonight, a few months ago, about forced investments. There is stuff that was in your life that you thought the devil took, and God said he had nothing to do with it. I was the one that took that out of your life because I needed you to sow it and forcefully invest it. Oh, y'all ain't going to say nothing. The Bible says in Mark chapter 10, verse 27 through 31, that if anyone loses houses, mother, brother, sister, father, anything, for the kingdom's sake, I'll restore it to him, the Lord says, in this lifetime, 100-fold. So there's some folk that walked out of your life and you're crying, but baby, you need to quit crying because God says, I got a better something lined up for you. But if you can't let go of Tyrone, you're going to be messed up. They'd shout if I was in Atlanta or something. They'd be shouting right by now. They'd be tearing the church up and having a song, tear the church up, tear the church. Watch this. God has set you up. There's stuff in your life, and you've been positioned on your job in certain places, and you've been positioned by certain people, and it has all been a divine setup. God, please understand, God, what he does it on purpose. I know some of you feel like you don't know what you're doing or where you're going or how stuff's going to work out. I'm going to make an announcement to you. God says, I got you right where I want you. Because your problem is you're a seeing I saint. You got to know everything before you go in there. But sometimes you got to learn how to close your eyes and follow your guide. You didn't hear what I just said. And the Bible says the Holy Ghost will teach you and guide you and lead you into all truth. Look at somebody and say, I got an anointing on me. And it's teaching me some stuff. So watch this. Please understand. But for you, you must declare what's over. Watch this. So many times as Christians, we have learned to just, you know, well, just whatever the Lord wants. And, you know, to sound real deep, we say, you know, I'm just seeking God's will. See, problem with all that is that I already know his will. Because he wrote it in his logos, his logic. The word of God is God's logic. It's how he thinks. Y'all ain't talking. It's how he operates. So if you need to know his will concerning your health, go to Isaiah, because Isaiah will tell you about his will concerning your health. You need to know his will concerning your prosperity. Go to 3 John, because 3 John will tell you. The apostle will get you right. Look at somebody and say, I know his will. But please understand this. You must declare what's over, and then you need to declare what's beginning. Watch this. When the Lord stepped into the earth, please understand, the earth was already here, but it was without form. And please understand, the Bible says what was on the face of the deep? Darkness. But please understand, darkness represents chaos and disorder. I wish somebody would just say something to me. Please understand, God did not step into just a big ball. He stepped into a ball that was disorderly. It was out of order, it was chaotic, it was jacked up. And that's how some folks' lives look. They look messed up and jacked up and chaotic and disorderly, and the darkness is there. But please understand, the only thing that interrupted the darkness is when the verse says, and then God said. The reason most folk don't see nothing happen in their lives is because they don't know how to run their mouth the right way. They know how to run their mouth to talk about sister so-and-so and the person over here, but they don't know how to run their mouth about something that's going to get them somewhere. If you stop spending all your time talking about folk and spending that time in your prayer closet, you can get something done. Y'all ain't going to sing. Preach, Bishop. All right. So say, declare an end. Declare a beginning. Before something new can begin, what is chaotic must end. You didn't hear what I just said. Before what is new can begin, what is chaotic must end. Watch this. That's why the Bible says in Isaiah 43:18, do not remember the what? In other words, he's saying, don't remember your chaos. Don't remember your disorder. Quit remembering all your jack-ups and mess-ups. He says, do not remember the what? Former things, nor consider the things of old. See, some of y'all, the reason why you're still connected to that person you ain't dated in 7 years is because you keep listening to our song.